The news about Beacon's project in Shakopee is welcome and timely news. Someone tried to shortcut the will of the community and they were called out and the process was corrected. I really think there are many people who run for office to prevent the government from doing anything at all. They speak of small government like it's a virtue. The great Republican, President Teddy Roosevelt, believed in fostering big business, but also big government to regulate it and to bust up monopoly companies like U.S. Steel and Standard Oil. We still have big oil, big auto, big telecom, big media, and big mafia. But the only big government they approve of is big defense. That means we have big problems, and the invisible hand of the marketplace will not save us from big homelessness, big fentanyl overdoses, big gun violence, or big climate change. We need the collective action of big government for some things, because big church is not equipped to do much more than advocate. So that's one of the things we do here. We advocate for big changes. And when one project is done, we find another and start again. It is in the nature of community to try to keep improving what we are doing. And both of the readings from today are about how this spiritual community of Jews and its inheritors, the Christians, try to live in community. In both of these readings, the instructions are explicit that we are to be involved in each other's business if things are not being done in the right way. This is very countercultural, because in the United States, we might as well have on our coins, not "In God We Trust," but "Mind Your Own Business." The problem is people don't mind their own businesses when they should, and they do when they shouldn't. And our engagement in building a faith community, a society, and a civilization takes some interaction to determine how we live together and when we should all pull in the same direction. It's an ongoing negotiation. It's an effort to formulate a way to answer the question, can't we all just get along? In Ezekiel, the voice of God is speaking in harsh terms at first. It's 2,500 years ago in a primitive desert community. Quote, "So you, mortal, Ezekiel, I have made you a sentinel for the house of Israel." In other words, you are your brother's keeper. "Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them a warning from me. We are responsible for bringing the kingdom of God to earth as it is in heaven," says God. Verse 8, "If I say to the wicked, O wicked ones, you will surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from their ways, the wicked shall die in their iniquity. It's our job to help call them out. But their blood I will require at your hand. Or we will face the ugly job of being the enforcers who have to deal out the penalty." This is the message to the ancient Jews. "But if you warn the wicked to turn from their ways, and they do not turn from their ways, the wicked shall die in their iniquity, and you will have saved your life from having to execute them yourself." It is our job to call out the wrongness when we see it, or we share in that sin. This is a deeply felt sense of connection to each other on earth, responsibility for each other. In this life, that we care enough to say something, to call it out, to try and make a difference in their lives. This is tricky stuff. In a very real sense, it is not our job to fix other people. It is our job to make them aware if they are creating a problem that need not exist. But their own taking of the final step is not guaranteed just because of our attempted intervention. So this ancient admonition to intervene in the lives of others cannot be taken literally. It has to be interpreted into the world in which we live. The reading is reminding Ezekiel of his call to be a watchman over the house of Israel. His prophetic task is to speak truth to power to the people of Israel and to its rulers, to call Israel to repentance when they fall short of the covenantal responsibilities before God. While this task involves declaring God's judgment for Israel's sins, it also means inviting Israel to repent in light of the loving kindness of God. So we don't correct in condemnation. We correct in calling people's attention to a God who forgives and wants what is best for us. In Ezekiel, divine justice is restorative, not punitive, in the end. It is to remove the cancer eating at the nation and bring them back into health so that they can embody the holiness of God, a holiness made of love, in their life and in their witness to the world. Without holiness, without this holiness, there can be no justice. Justice is love made manifest in public. God wants repentance, and also for those cast out, restoration to the community. Say to them, as I live, says the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the spiritual death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from their ways and live. Turn back from your evil ways. For why will you die, O those of Israel? End quote. Change your path. Start again. Repent means turn. God wants us to live well and in peace. Turn away from the path that you are on. In the same way, Jesus is teaching about how the body of Christ can maintain its cohesion. He is saying we should be able to solve these problems among ourselves. Talk to each other. Trust in the connection we have with each other. Try and make it work. Verse 15, if another member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. In other words, you have regained that person into the realm of the community where they will listen and learn. You are connected again. He continues in verse 16, but if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector, end quote. In other words, acknowledge that this person does not want to be part of what makes a community work. They are like Gentiles who do not believe in God, or like tax collectors who collaborate with the Romans to oppress and to steal our living from us as a matter of course. They are outside the community by choice, by belief, by behavior. But if they repent, they are to be welcomed back. The goal is to bind us together, and Jesus is the binding force that is available to us. And here, ladies and gentlemen, and everyone in between, I will illustrate this using Ringo Starr, drummer of the Beatles, as an example of what the Holy Spirit does or can do. If you remember the Beatles, they were a rock band that built their skills in the rough bars of the Hamburg red light district. They picked up a drummer the day before they left that they were not happy about, Pete Best, because they had taught him to keep a beat, but that was as good as he got. John Lennon said, he was a lousy drummer. He never got better. And in subsequent analysis of recordings with Pete on it, it shows that he really could not keep a beat. He was slowed down by the end of the song. He was off. They got into the studio and the producer, George Martin, said, look, boys, you can use him in your live shows if you like, but I can't use him in here. So they brought in Ringo Starr. Ringo was a more famous drummer in a more successful band, and they were friends from shared gigs in Hamburg. Ringo knew their stuff and picked it up right away. Paul McCartney said, there were a couple of times when Pete couldn't make a gig and Ringo filled in, and Paul said, we all felt like, whoa, this is how it's supposed to sound. After that, after a couple of sessions, George Martin agreed. He said, the drummer has to be this binding force to keep the band together. The Holy Spirit can bind us together as a community if we're all listening to that same driving beat. Let me use another example. The Holy Spirit is like a marriage counselor. This example is ready to hand because my wife is a family therapist, which includes marriage counseling. When she enters into a process of working with a couple, she has to be an objective resource so that both parties feel heard and respected. Kirsten tells them, I am not here to advocate for one side or the other. I am here to advocate for the marriage. And because they know she is advocating for the marriage, they trust her to speak what needs to be said, to help them out from making the same mistakes over and over again. There are a couple of good jokes about this, too, from different comedians. One woman said that she's been married for a long time. I think I've told this one before. And she said that a friend of hers came to stay with them for a while, and her marriage was good, but her friend is like this beautiful person, sweet and cute and in good shape. And this comedian said, it awakened in me something unfamiliar, something I have not felt in a long time. Suddenly, I found myself trying. Then there was a joke from a guy comic. My wife says I never listen. At least I think that's what she said. I'm not sure. So when we are talking about the relationship of two people, it's the smallest example of what a community is built of, trying and listening. That's two people trying to make something work, to build a tiny community. By helping each other to be better people, by teaching and learning, by sharing and listening. And if it is a marriage that has faith in it, that includes the Holy Spirit, I think it has a better chance because both partners will try to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit in their conversation. They will try to hear the marriage counselor of the Spirit connecting them. The power of Jesus saying, I'm here to advocate for the marriage. And if it sounds like I know what I'm talking about, I just want to make sure you understand. Kirsten and I had a bitter 10-minute argument this morning about whether her eggs were cooked 6 minutes or not. In our congregational life, we hear God when God says, I am here to advocate for the congregation. And because we have welcomed Jesus into our lives in this congregation, we can feel his presence in our work together. And it elevates us above and beyond what we could hope to be if we were stuck just being ourselves. We can rise above. Suddenly, we are listening. Suddenly, we are learning. I have had my own experiences with a lot of marriages that I know about having problems because one or the other, usually the man, has trouble learning from the other, usually a woman. It could go either way. Both men and women have male and masculine and feminine tendencies. But men were taught, often were taught that they're supposed to be the ones that have all the answers, and their ego gets deflated if they're made to feel stupid. When the thing that would actually help is if they understood that there is something to learn from their spouse and that to fully enter into that conversation, that women are a wonderful source of knowledge and information and wisdom that can go in either direction. But I am willing to risk being censored for sexism if I make this general observation based on my experience, which I think I can do. The Native American tradition includes the insight that men are supposed to provide for women and protect them from other men, and women are supposed to teach men about what it means to be a human being and what it means to be around people. Again, that's not everyone. But men are often taught that women's ideas are beneath us, that feelings are stupid, that men have all the answers. Many churches teach this as theology. And the men that got brought up like that are doomed to failure. And often men are excluded from those conversations that women have because women are tired of trying and being blown off or ignored. There's a lot in the air these days about how men are unsure of how to be in the world. And women who are tired of trying to find a man that will give a relationship an honest try. These are gender-specific generalizations, again. But we all have masculine and feminine sides to ourselves, and I know my masculine side loves to learn but hates to be taught. I resent not knowing everything all the time, and I react very defensively when I realize I don't know something. We are in trouble if we think that others have nothing to teach us. We need to be open to learning new things from sources that we may have overlooked before. For example, here, Jesus is teaching us several things about faith life in the community. First, that would-be leaders in the community are to be as humble and teachable as children. Next, Jesus' followers must attend to matters of personal morality so that they don't become stumbling blocks in the paths of others. We have to be good examples in these things. Third, faithful disciples cultivate care for one another in the manner that Paul writes about to the Romans. Owe no one anything, he says, except to love one another. Fourth, be persistent in resolving conflict. Then be prepared to offer forgiveness to one another 70 times 7, if necessary. Conflicts will arise. It is perhaps the most difficult thing to address. There's one thing we can be sure of in the era of rapid social changes that affect church life. It is that conflicts will arise. The question is, how will we deal with it? Churches are certainly aware of this. In every search process for a pastoral leader that takes place, the question should always come up, how do you handle conflict? The candidate also has to request of the community, how have you handled conflicts in the past? And so it goes. Here, Jesus speaks about the matter with assurance. When two or three are gathered in my name, even to deal with conflict, I am there in the midst of them. That is how we can handle conflicts. We can call in the great marriage counselor, Jesus, to advocate for both sides. We can call in the great prophetic voice of God to call us to higher ground and sterner virtues and deeper righteousness. And we can call in the Holy Spirit, who, like Ringo, will be a binding force that powers us, who gives us an excellent spiritual tempo and helps us to make powerful music together. In community, we can become more than who we are when we are only our own selves. We can be part of a greater good if we listen. Let us pray. Dear God, the actions we need to take in community are complicated and tricky. When we hold government accountable, we can root out the enemies of progress and make things right so that we can move forward together injustice. When we work together for the betterment of our little corner of these highways, we do it so that there's a home for the missions we foster, the work we are doing, and the spiritual home that nurtures us. When we are facing each other one-on-one, we can make beautiful music happen between ourselves if we hear God's presence in our efforts. Jesus said, "If you both gather in my name, I will be there." So help us to welcome him. All this we ask in your name. Amen.